Okay, so well, topic of my two lectures is introduction to linear viscoelasticity. All right. Obviously, as the name suggests, linear viscoelasticity means a material that shows viscous response as well as elastic response at the same time. All right. Those who have come from solid mechanics background, of course, know little bit about elastic response. Those who have come from fluid mechanics background, all of us know little bit about perfectly elastic response represented by Hookean solid and perfectly viscous response represented by Newtonian fluid. All right. Viscoelastic response is obviously in between both of them. Why I am saying in between will become apparent to you in a while. So, these are the materials that show viscous response over certain time scale, elastic response over certain time scale, and these materials are present everywhere around us. All right, and therefore, they are very important materials. All right. I will not spend much time on introduction of this particular word viscoelasticity, or as a matter of fact linear. All these particular words, this is an introductory class. So, all these words will become apparent to you, clear to you in a while. What we shall begin with is what is the molecular origin of elasticity, and then we will kind of relate a general subject of viscoelasticity to the same. All right. So, molecular origin of mechanical response. I am not saying elasticity per se, I am saying mechanical response over here. All right. So, whenever any material, whether it be in liquid state or solid state, when this material is deformed, or if you want to deform that material, then you must apply force on it. All right. Why you need to apply force on it? Because the molecular arrangement in that solid or in liquid is such that every atom or molecule experiences certain energetic interaction with its neighbors. There is force acting on every element of that particular solid or liquid, all right, let it be atom or molecule, and that force is exerted by the surrounding molecules. All right. This force essentially is necessary to maintain equilibrium in that particular body. When you apply deformation field, you are moving that particular body from its equilibrium state to a certain higher energy state. All right, and therefore, in order to cause that deformation, you must apply force on that deformation, force on that particular body. All right. So, what we shall do is that we shall consider one very simple situation wherein we have a atomic arrangement in a cubic lattice. It is a thought, okay, we will consider this kind of arrangement. This kind of arrangement suggests that, well, every atom or molecule experiences some kind of an energetic interaction with its neighbors, and obviously, if you move this atom from its equilibrium state, all right, of course, you must apply force on it in order to move it. All right. So, what we shall do is that we shall consider a very simple situation where we deform this particular solid only in one direction. We will deform this particular solid in one direction, so that a spring which has original length of A essentially deforms to something which is R. All right, you can consider that you are deforming it in this direction. You must keep one thing in mind, that not just the interatomic distance, average interatomic distance is around A, but the typical cross sectional area, this is around A square. So, this is kind of an order of magnitude analysis, this is not an exact analysis, you can call this as a scaling analysis. All right. So, this particular this cross section is A square, and this particular distance is also a, all right. And what has been done is that you apply force so that this, there is a strain induced in this material now, which actually this strain can be simply be then written as R minus A by A. All right. So this is the strain induced in this particular material. All right. What is force required to kind of cause this particular strain? That force is simply K into R minus A, where K is a spring constant and R is the deformation that we have caused and A is the equilibrium distance. So anything that is in addition to equilibrium distance is multiplied by spring constant is the force. All right. So with this we can write down stress equal to F divided by A square, because this is the A square is the typical area scale associated with this particular bond. And if this is stress, if this is strain, then we can write down Young modulus E of this material as sigma divided by gamma, which is equal to K into R minus A divided by A square, and gamma is, we can write down A divided by R minus A, which gives us K by A. All right. So the Young modulus is essentially associated with the spring constant divided by the length scale associated with that bond. All right. Now you can consider that every, there is some kind of an intermolecular potential associated with interaction, let us say a given element has with its surrounding. All right. Let that intermolecular potential be represented by U of R, and what we essentially then we can do is that we can carry out a Taylor series expansion of this particular interatomic potential. You can typically refer to this particular interatomic potential as, if this is R by A and this is R by A is equal to 1 and this is U, then there is a minima associated with this interatomic potential at R is equal to A. All right. So if you consider position of this at roughly some like R by A equal to 1, then any movement in, we are only considering one direction, you can consider this to be a three dimensional body also. So any movement in either this or this direction increases energy. All right. So we can actually carry out Taylor series expansion of this, we can carry out Taylor series expansion of this at U is equal to A, yes, at R is equal to A, which gives plus higher order terms. All right, this is very straightforward. Now what is this, the first derivative of U with respect to R obtained at R is equal to A? This should be equal to, this should be equal to 0, because obviously there is, this is an equilibrium state. All right. So that actually kind of, we can simply get rid of this particular term then. What remains is this, and if the interaction between this particular molecule with its surroundings, if it is represented by a linear spring, then we can simply represent this, anyway we can represent this as du is equal to f ds. If it is linear spring, then we can represent this f by this, which is equal to k into r minus a. Ds is dr, but we can always write down this as dr minus a, which is equal to du, and we can integrate this to give u is equal to, or I should say u at r is equal to k by 2 r or r square plus some constant, and that constant is computed at r is equal to a. We know that r equal to a, u of r is equal to u of u. So, we can say that u of r is equal to u of u at a plus k by 2 r minus, well, there is no plus here. It is a linear spring, so there is no further kind of term beyond this particular term. Now, we can directly kind of compare this particular expression with this particular expression, and what we get is, why is it? Let me just write it over here. Why? So, direct comparison gives us that the second derivative of u at r is equal to a is nothing but the spring constant k. All right. Now, what we shall do is that we will assume a certain functional form to this particular u, an arbitrary functional form, wherein we will say that u of r is equal to some epsilon f of r by a. Okay. So, this is some kind of an arbitrary functional form that we have assumed, wherein at r is equal to a, we will say that u is equal to minus epsilon, which means that f of 1 is equal to minus 1. We are simply saying that this particular well depth is epsilon, all right, which also kind of suggests that this is the energy associated with this particular bond. And so, if that is the case, we can now take this derivative. So, we can always write down d 2 u by d r 2 to be equal to d 2 u by d r by a 2 into a square over here, which is equal to epsilon by a square and this essentially will then be f double prime of r by a, and we can now write down this as, we have to compute this at r is equal to 1, which leads to, so we will write down k is equal to d 2 u by d r 2 at r equal to a is equal to then simply epsilon by a square into f double prime of 1. All right. You will soon now realize where we are going to. So, this is k. However, we have already, we had computed over here that e is nothing but equal to, e was Young modulus, e is nothing but, what did we obtain? It was k by a, which essentially gives us this epsilon by a cube, and this is some kind of an arbitrary constant. We will represent this as capital A. All right. What does this suggest? This suggests that Young's modulus or Young modulus associated with a solid body is directly proportional to the energy, bond energy associated with the molecules, and 1 over a cube is nothing but the density of bonds. So, you can essentially kind of consider this to be number of bonds per unit volume. Which means that number of bonds per unit volume, if these increase, you have greater Young modulus, or energy of interaction if it increases, you have greater Young modulus. All right. So, now you will realize that why modulus is known as energy density, okay, or modulus can be represented as some kind of an energy density, where this energy is nothing but the bond energy associated with the molecules. Fair enough. Now, this is as far as elastic material is concerned. Of course, if your force is kind of, if you apply force in such a fashion that the chain stretches significantly, so that the energy induced in that particular spring is greater than the bond energy, then obviously bond will break and there will be dissipation, all right, but we are not talking about that limit as far as elastic solid is concerned, all right. But now we will now independently look at what happens in liquids. So, okay, let us not worry about that. Okay, so let us consider a liquid now. What is the case in case of a liquid? Typically in liquid, of course not always, that the free volume associated with liquid is more than that of in case of solids, not always, usually, all right. Of course, there are cases where solid gets transforms to liquid, its free volume actually decreases. There are some cases like that also. Can you tell me which is such case typical? Yes. Ice floats over water, right? Which means that the density of water is more than that of ice, all right. That is one typical case, but in general solid has lesser free volume, lesser volume around the atoms and that it is filled by atoms and molecules. So, what is the case with liquids is that the atomic or molecular arrangement is very irregular. Atomic or molecular arrangement is very irregular. However, if we see the arrangement closer to kind of given atom or molecule, over small distances is not significantly disordered. There is still some kind of a systematic placement of various atoms and molecules over a small length scale. Why is that the case? Because the very fact that this particular matter is in liquid state, condensed state, there exists some kind of interatomic or intermolecular interactions of this molecule with its surrounding. Obviously, the epsilon associated with that is significantly smaller in case of liquids than in case of solids. Essentially, now going to do is that we of course know that in solids atoms and molecules are continuously undergoing thermal motion, but these thermal motions are of a very small length scale, so that the atoms and molecules do not leave their place and go and kind of translate. That is not the case with liquids. The atoms and molecules in liquid are also continuously undergoing thermal motion, but that thermal motion has significant part of translational motion. Why? Because there is more space to move around at that particular temperature and pressure, all right. Now, and of course, the energy because of that particular higher temperature, there is a greater energy associated with that particular molecules or atoms. Now, let us take a snapshot, all right. Let us kind of, if you take a picture and not worrying about uncertainty principle, let us assume that this essentially is the position of these particular atoms or molecules at that particular snapshot, all right. And now, what we are going to do is that at that instant, let the material undergo some kind of a deformation. So, this has gone to this. Instantaneously, immediately after deformation, what you will realize that the position of respective atoms and molecules obviously has changed because the deformation has been applied, but these atoms and molecules have not changed its neighbors at this time, because this is extremely small time, 0 plus we are saying it, immediately after applying deformation. Fair enough? And we are also saying that there of course exists certain bond between these particular atoms and molecules, and this bond energy is extremely small compared to that of solids. All right. Now, after deformation, we are, as I said, that each of these particular molecules is undergoing some kind of a molecular vibration, and that vibration is continuous. All right. Typical frequency of molecular vibration is about 10 to the power minus 30 into 10 to the power minus 14 hertz. So, for times smaller than this, so if you are talking about time scale of 10 to the power minus, let us say 17 or 18, then you will find that these molecules are practically still, or these atoms are practically still, all right, and therefore they have not changed their neighbors, and there is some kind of a interaction of this particular molecule with its surrounding, just the way it was there in case of the previous example of solids, just the way it was. So therefore, liquids can now be considered to have something called instantaneous modulus. Liquids can now be considered to have instantaneous modulus. Let it be liquid water. It will still have that instantaneous modulus over extremely small time scale. All right, because over that time scale, it will not change its neighbors, and there is certain interaction of this particular molecule with its neighbors, with epsilon obviously significantly smaller than that of solids. But however, as time passes, this particular, all these, the molecule under observation as well as its neighbors will start vibrating. All right, as minus 17 will go closer to this particular thing, it will start vibrating. All right, and if epsilon is the bond energy, then on a given attempt of vibration over a particular time scale, a probability that this atom under observation will move out of its neighbors essentially is given by Boltzmann distribution, which essentially is e to the power minus epsilon by kT, and the time scale therefore associated with diffusing out is simply given by, if this is the natural frequency of vibration, then this is the time scale associated with moving out of that particular, moving out of its own cage. All right. So, this is the time scale over which material remembers its past. This is the time scale over which material remembers its past. Fair enough. Or also you can say this, that after you apply deformation, whenever you apply deformation, you must apply force. Deformation means applying force over a certain length scale, all right, which means that you are adding energy to it. This energy will get stored over the time scale, which is extremely small compared to this particular time scale. Okay. However, over this time scale, as material will forget its past, that energy will get dissipated. All right. So now you can look upon this particular time scale, which is popularly known as relaxation time associated with a liquid, as time scale over which material stores energy, as a time scale over which material stores energy. Is that all right? Now you should be able to appreciate this particular aspect, that how intimately this modulus and relaxation time are related. keep in mind that whatever discussion that we are having is primarily associated with materials that have energetic interactions between its atoms and molecules. All right. If solid is formed by pure entropic interactions, then it is not exactly what we are doing, the way we are doing does not apply. All right. So, in case of pure entropic interactions, there is no energetic interactions between atoms or molecules. Is that all right? Like a crystal formed by hard spheres, okay, there is no energetic interaction. Okay. A different kind of analysis is needed to be carried out for that case, but we are not talking about entropic case, we are talking about energetic or enthalpic situations. And the instantaneous modulus now is represented, and represented by G is, or I should say, is proportional to E cube. On the other hand, the relaxation time is nu e to the power so this is kind of a typical relationship that you will observe, you know, of course bring this also over here, typical relationship you will observe between modulus and relaxation time. So let us talk about liquids. Liquids have instantaneous modulus and they have relaxation time. All right. What about solids? In case of solids, what happens is that this epsilon is so significantly larger than kT that this relaxation time is extraordinarily large. This relaxation time is extraordinarily large. All right. Which means that in case of elastic solids, over that much time period, energy will should remain stored. So, are you able to appreciate rheological distinction between liquids and solids? Still, I have not made distinction, I am still talking about extraordinarily large and very small. When I say something is large and something is small, I must differentiate it with respect to some other independent time scale, which I will come to in a moment. But before that, I also want to kind of take you to another kind of relationship that very naturally arises, particularly for liquids, you can say also for solids. And that is viscosity of that particular material. Viscosity by nature, you can see its dimensions, is a product of modulus scale and time scale of the material. So, you can consider this to be, sorry, what am I writing? All right. So, therefore, what you can then write down is this is something like A epsilon A cube nu to the power minus 1 e to the power. This is the kind of typical Arrhenius relationship which we know for viscosity, the typical Arrhenius relationship that we know for the viscosity. Is that all right? I will not go into details of, well, how viscosity changes with temperature and all. That is kind of, you can find out it in any standard book. All right. Now, let me come back to my previous question, and that is for liquids, I said that this time scale over which energy is stored is very small. I said for solids, this time scale is very large. All right. And then I said that I should not be talking in terms of what is small or what is large. I must have an independent time scale to qualify what is small and what is large, is not it? And that independent time scale is my observation time scale. How much time, over how much time I am able to observe a particular material? Do I have capacity to observe material over time scales smaller than these time scales? At least at present, no. And I do not think that we can ever be able to observe material over such small time scales. On the other hand, what is the typical largest time scale over which we can observe material? Well, history tells us that, well, 2000 years, maximum 3000 years. There are of course some structures in Greece which are 3000, let us say 4000 years old, not more than that. If we decide to observe something for 4000 years from now or even 100 years from now, we will not be there to observe that, somebody else will have to do that observation for us. So, with our typical observation window of 10 to the power let us say minus 7 or minus 8 per second, or sorry minus 7 to minus 8 second to something like, well, I will put here 1000 years. This is the kind of typical length scale of typical time scale associated with our observation. As far as a human being is concerned, we have kind of a span of observation from few fraction of some seconds to few days, that also as far as our memory allows, all right. And now, if our kind of minimum time scale, smallest time scale of our human observation let us say is 0.1 second, then material which does not store energy beyond that particular typical time scale, we will safely call that particular material liquid, because over our observation time scale there is never a storage of energy. On the other hand, if let us say we have this glass panel that let us say dissipates energy over let us say 10,000 years, I am assuming that. Will I ever be able to observe that dissipation in my lifetime? No. So, I will call that particular material as solid. All right. This is a completely independent view of, not exactly independent view than thermodynamics to qualify something as liquid or solid. Whenever I say that there is a time scale associated with material, thermodynamically speaking that material is always in liquid state. Keep that in mind. I am not talking about thermodynamic solids over here. Thermodynamic solids cannot relax over any time scale. Thermodynamic solids cannot relax over any time scale. So, I am not talking about thermodynamic solids over here. I am talking about liquids only. All right. But a glass which is not a thermodynamic solid, which is a thermodynamic kind of a liquid, appears to be a solid over length scale of my observation, all right. So, by considering that God is a very big entity and which has much more time scale to observe than us, is not God observing the whole evolution of humankind? So, God's observation time scale is millions and millions of years, all right. So, for God everything will appear to be a liquid, all right. And that is precisely what a prophetess in the first book of Torah, which is the first testimony, in the chapter in the book of Judges, what Deborah said is that even mountains melt in front of God. She had a different connotation to say, but well, of course, some rheologists picked that up and they said that, well, since God has huge time scales, even the mountains can be seen to be flowing in front of God. So, therefore, a number, a dimensionless number was proposed, and that dimensional number is called as Deborah number, which is nothing but the relaxation time of the material divided by an observation time scale associated with that experiment, all right. If relaxation time is huge, which means that Deborah number is far, far greater than 1, a material will appear to be a solid. On the other hand, a Deborah number far, far smaller than 1, material. So, in this limit one will always have storage of energy, in this limit one will always have dissipation of energy. However, when Deborah number is of the order of 1, you have a very peculiar situation, because this is your observation time scale, okay, And if your observation time scale goes over, let us say, 2 to 3 orders of magnitude, then for smaller observation time scale, you will find the same material to be storing energy. But if you wait little longer, you will observe that material is dissipating energy. So, therefore, in the same experiment, you can have a Deborah number changing from, let us say, 10 to the power minus 3 to 10 to the power 3, and you will find that over the 6 decades of Deborah number, on one hand you have liquid like behavior, on the other hand you have solid like behavior, and that is essentially leads to viscoelasticity. Is that all right? Is that all right? So, with this now kind of will, this was essentially kind of the background associated with viscoelasticity. Now, what we will do is that we will first kind of play with some toy models of viscoelasticity, and then I will go to more formal treatment of viscoelasticity. All right. So, obviously, as name suggests, it has viscous component, it has elastic component. So, we will represent the elastic component by a spring and viscous component by a dashpot. All right. This spring will consider to be a Hookean spring, where stress is essentially given by modulus into strain, while this dashpot is considered to be a Newtonian material whose stress is nothing but given by viscosity into gamma dot. Is that all right? And what we shall essentially do is that for these materials, we will see essentially two types of flow deformations. One is a creep deformation, wherein at time t is equal to t 1, we apply step stress of magnitude sigma 0, and at time t is equal to t 1, we apply step strain of magnitude gamma 0. All right. So, what we shall do is that we will first begin with a spring and dashpot, and then we will kind of go with some typical combination of spring and dashpot, which represents viscoelasticity. Yes. Okay, so that's a good question. A flow will always takes place upon application of stress. There is nothing. There won't be any flow if there is no stress. Under gravitational field, there is always stress. All right. But if there is no stress, let us say you are talking about somewhere in the atmosphere, somewhere kind of a place where there is no force at all, there won't be any flow. So, well, there are kind of various ways to define yield stress fluids. A popular belief is that yield stress fluids do flow, but over an extraordinarily large time scale. Okay. Now, when I am saying that if glass flows, where are your yield stress fluids? Yield stress fluids will surely flow, right? If glass flows, then yield stress fluid, are you ready to wait for 1000 years to see whether yield stress fluid has flowed or not? So, yield, but I will come to this particular point in next class. All right. Your question is really good, and we will come to this particular point about what happens in yield stress fluids in the next class, where I will kind of discuss, if time permits of course, yield stress fluids thixotropy associated with the material. All right. Okay. So, we will kind of work with step stress, and we will work with step strain also. Now, I will kind of now increase my speed, because which we are not going to kind of finish things that I plan to if I go so slow. So, let us talk about spring over here, and this is dashpot. For spring, we know that application of step stress will lead to, of course, strain, where strain induced in material is going to be sigma 0 by g. At the same time. So, there will be an instantaneous strain material. All right. As far as, okay, let us talk about first spring, and same is the case. So, this, so gamma is equal to this, sigma is equal to gamma 0 into g, and I will have identical response for stress also. This was spring, all right. Application of stress will lead to instantaneous strain in the material, and application of strain will lead to instantaneous stress in the material, all right. That is as far as spring is concerned. As far as dashpot is concerned, let us first talk about application of strain. Application of strain will essentially lead to, you can clearly see over here. So, what stress will, let us first talk about stress over here. I will come to strain in a moment. So, essentially what you have is gamma dot is equal to sigma by eta, sigma is constant. So, gamma is nothing but sigma 0 eta into t plus c. If we consider that time t equal to 0, there is no strain in the material, which will be the case with dashpot. We essentially have this behavior, which means that at time t equal to t1, the strain in material essentially kind of will go like this, all right, with this slope as gamma dot. Fair enough. As far as step stress is concerned, what you now have is that, step strain is concerned, that for step strain you essentially are kind of giving a jerk to it and extending this particular thing to a different strain level, all right, which means that you will have to function, you will have to express this gamma dot as some kind of an impulse function over here, and that will essentially be the response of stress over here. So, stress will be an impulse, and then again it will be equal to 0, because in case of dashpot gamma dot will be equal to 0 after strain remains constant. So, there cannot be stress in material beyond that particular point, but at the point at which you apply step strain there will be an impulse. Fair enough. So, this is as far as a single spring and dashpot is concerned. And now what is done, what we shall do is that we shall now represent two combinations of this spring and dashpot given by. So, let us first talk about a series combination of spring and dashpot. So, this combination is known as Maxwell model. All right. In this particular case, you can very clearly see that a stress applied to this particular Maxwell element will be same in dashpot as well as in spring. So, stress is same, but strain is additive over here. So, what we have is total strain is equal to strain in spring plus strain in dashpot. We will consider modulus of spring to be g, viscosity of dashpot to be eta. So, we shall simply write down this as, we will take one more derivative and we will write down gamma dot s is nothing but equal to sigma dot by g plus gamma dot d is equal to sigma by eta. So, this becomes the governing equation for a Maxwell model. Pardon me, I am going little forwards. I only have 40 minutes in today's class. All right. So, this is as far as Maxwell model is concerned, and what we shall now do is that we will try to kind of get its dependence. Is it okay if I do not solve this now kind of completely, because if I start solving for each of these, there will be time to only up to 10:30, I will kind of consume everything in that only. So, we will just write down how the behavior will look like for creep and step strain. Actually, if I solve it, it will give a direct better, because then we will be able to get to know what relaxation time and everything is. Let us do that, let us not worry about time, because at least Maxwell model is very important, both Maxwell as well as Kelvin Voigt models are important. Okay, so, first is creep, wherein what we essentially do is that we apply constant stress to material at time t equal to t1. So, when we apply constant stress to material, this particular term will be equal to 0. So, for creep, we have gamma dot is equal to sigma by eta, all right, So, we essentially have gamma is equal to sigma by eta into T plus some constant. But here keep in mind that unlike dashpot, this expression is very similar to that of dashpot, but unlike that of dashpot, what happens is that at time t is equal to t1, a stress is applied, sorry, this is sigma 0, this is sigma 0, a stress is applied which will lead to instantaneous strain in dashpot in spring, all right. That instantaneous strain in spring is given by, so at time t equal to t1, instantaneous strain in spring is essentially given by all right. So, this essentially is now C. So, we can write down gamma is equal to sigma 0 by eta t plus sigma 0 by g minus sigma 0 by eta into t, all right, which essentially gives me sigma 0 by g plus sigma 0 by eta into, sorry, this is t 1. What I have is this is t 1, so t minus t 1, all right. So, the corresponding response is going to be, there will be an instantaneous strain and there will be a continuous deformation of dashpot, all right, which essentially is given by this particular expression for creep. Fair enough. Now, we will write down expression for step strain over here. Oh, I did not mean to say first testimony, it is old testimony of Bible. Okay, so this is as far as the creep behavior is concerned. We can also actually do one thing, we can add another flavor to it. Let us get the stress equal to 0 at time t2. So, if we do that, then what essentially we get is that gamma dot will then be equal to 0, all right, if you put stress equal to 0, because here both are equal to 0, and then strain will remain constant, but that will be associated with gamma of t2. What will be gamma of t2? Gamma of t2 will be essentially only this much part, because this will get recovered, all right. So, just keep in mind that you have this particular spring and dashpot in series, you have applied constant stress to it, there is an instantaneous deformation in the spring, there is a continuous deformation in the dashpot, and at some point of time you, what you do is that you release that particular stress. Deformation in dashpot will not be recovered, but deformation in spring will get recovered. So, what you will have is that deformation in spring will get recovered and there will be a permanent deformation in the Maxwell fluid that will remain over here. This is essentially this part, and the recovered part is precisely going to be equal to this one. Is that all right? So, that is as far as Maxwell model is concerned, it is creep. Now, we are talking about, let us talk about the step strain associated with Maxwell model. Again, for step strain, you can clearly see that sigma dot by g plus sigma by eta is equal to 0, because gamma dot remains constant over here. What you can do is that, then you can solve this particular expression as d ln sigma by dt is equal to minus of g by eta, all right. I am skipping few steps over here, but you can pretty much clearly see that this is very obvious, and then you can simply now write down ln sigma is equal to minus g by eta into t plus some constant, all right. And what that constant is, that at time t is equal to t1, okay, how much is the stress induced in material, at time t equal to t1, if I applied step strain to this particular material, you can see here that the entire strain in the material at time t equal to 0, there won't be any permanent instantaneous deformation in dashpot. So, applying a step strain, that all instantaneous deformation will go in spring, because only spring has capacity to undergo instantaneous deformation, all right. So, that deformation is going to be ln g into gamma 0 is equal to minus g by eta into t1 plus c. So, if you solve this, you will get ln sigma is equal to ln g gamma 0, where gamma 0 is the magnitude of applied step strain, minus g by eta t minus t1, all right. So, you have this minus t, and when it will go here, it will become plus. So, you will get something like this, and then you can write down sigma, then therefore, is equal to g gamma 0 e to the power minus t minus tau 1 by some kind of a, you can see here this is g by eta. We have already defined that g by eta or eta by g is the time scale associated with the material. We will call this time scale as relaxation time of material tau r. So, this is what we get, all right, which means that what will happen is, in case of, so this is Maxwell, what will happen is that instantaneously there will be some stress induced in the material because of spring, all right, and as a function of time it will decay to 0. Okay. This is nothing but g gamma 0 e to the power minus t minus t 1 by tau r, where this tau r, which is ratio of viscosity divided by modulus, is known as relaxation time of a material, is known as relaxation time of a material. See therefore, how naturally when you have an elastic element and viscous element together, you get a something called relaxation time, all right. The way liquid shows, this material also shows an instantaneous modulus. However, as time passes, see what will happen in this particular case. When you have an instantaneous step strain on this particular material, there will be an instantaneous deformation in the spring, but as time passes, this total strain is remained constant, but there will be deformation of dashpot at the cost of spring. So, spring will slowly relax and dashpot will essentially kind of get extended, leading to dissipation of the energy which was stored in the spring, all right. So, you have instantaneous storage and delayed dissipation, or dissipation progressively occurring over time, all right. As stress, as energy dissipates which was stored in the spring, you essentially have relaxation in the material, which will essentially also lead to relaxation of stress. Since Maxwell model shows behavior very similar to that of liquids, or I should say viscoelastic liquids, this is called viscoelastic liquid, okay, or I should say, since it shows behavior similar to liquids, this is called viscoelastic liquid. On the other hand, what you have is Kelvin void model. Okay. So, now let us do this analysis for Kelvin void model. In case of Kelvin void model, what you do is that you have an, rather than having series arrangement, you have parallel arrangement of spring and dashpot. All right. Now, you can see over here that the strain in both these particular elements is constant, sorry, I should say identical, not constant, but stress in this plus stress in this is total stress. So, I will write down stress equal to sigma s
plus sigma dash part,
all right, which gives sigma s is nothing but equal to, this is spring, so this is g into gamma, gamma is same for both spring as well as dash part, plus I am sorry, what am I writing here, oh yeah, so yeah, that is fine, and it will be eta gamma dot, all right. So, sigma is equal to g gamma plus eta gamma dot is governing equation for Kelvin-Voigt model, all right. So, now what I shall do is that rather than solving Kelvin-Voigt model, we will just kind of discuss the response of Kelvin-Voigt model. You should be able, definitely be able to imagine these responses. Now, remember, imagine that you are applying step stress to it, okay, which means that you have applied, let us say you have kind of put a weight on over here. What will happen? Slowly there will be deformation in this particular material, all right. And to begin with, since there would not be any instantaneous deformation in the spring, at time t equal to 0, this energy in spring will be equal to 0 because there is no deformation, okay. Energy in spring is always proportional to strain in spring, that is not the case over here. So, at time t equal to 0, as you apply this particular weight to it or you apply step stress to it, a gamma dot will immediately set in over here. So, there will be finite gamma dot in the dashpot at strain equal to 0, which means that dashpot will start extending. To begin with, all the stress, the total stress will be taken up by the dashpot, and there would not be any strain in the, there would not be any stress in the spring. As time passes, applied stress is constant. As strain increases, spring will start accumulating energy, all right, and the amount of stress then applied to dashpot will go on decreasing. A time will come when the stress, applied stress, will be equal to stress in the spring, and there won't be any stress in this particular branch, okay. So, what will happen is that for Kelvin-Voigt, you essentially have a strain response that looks something like this, all right, where this particular value is nothing but the value associated with that of spring, which is, this is strain, so this is sigma 0 divided by g. The typical time scale over which this particular state is reached, this time scale is known as retardation time, and this retardation time is equal to again eta over g, but keep in mind that only eta over g in a Maxwell type of construction is relaxation time, eta over g in Kelvin-Voigt type of construction is called retardation time. And now let us imagine that material has kind of reached its maximum strain for given applied stress, and at time t 2 you put this stress equal to 0. What will happen? Let us say I have extended this, there is a stress, now the stress is entirely in this particular branch, and now if you release it, if you remove the stress, then again slowly this particular spring will recover and the complete deformation of the dashpot will also be recovered because both are in parallel, all right. So, what you essentially have then is you have complete recovery of the material. So, in a Kelvin-Voigt model type of setup, the total energy is always stored, it never gets dissipated. That is not the case over here, all right. So, therefore, Kelvin-Voigt model is a typical representation of a solid like material. Kelvin-Voigt model has infinite relaxation time. Kelvin-Voigt model, single mode Kelvin wave model, I should mention, has infinite relaxation time. It does not relax at all. Okay, there is absolutely no relaxation. This is recovery of strain. In a step strain experiment, when you apply a step strain on it, there will be an instantaneous strain in spring as well as in dashpot. All right, the strain in the spring will lead to permanent stress in the material. Strain in the dashpot, instantaneous strain in the dashpot will lead to an impulse like of response. So, what will happen is that you will have an impulse and then you will have a constant stress in case of a Kelvin Voigt model. Is that all right? That is how a Kelvin Voigt, what you can do is that as a homework, you can solve the way we did it for Maxwell model, you can do it for Kelvin Voigt model. It is very easy, it is very straightforward. All right, you should be able to get these responses out of it. Since there is never a relaxation, it is a infinite relaxation time body. All right, keep in mind these are two different terms. This is relaxation of a stress. Relaxation is always used in rheology, relaxation is always used with stress. In rheology, relaxation is never used with strain. Strain never relaxes, strain recovers. All right, recovery of a strain is not a relaxation phenomenon. Recovery of a strain is a very elastic phenomenon, which is opposite of relaxation. You should never confuse with these two terms when it comes to rheology. I do not know about other subjects how terminology is developed is in that particular subject. In rheology, strain recovers, stress relaxes. Stress is akin to energy, relaxation is akin to dissipation. Recovery is an elastic phenomenon, it is not akin to dissipation. All right? Okay. So, this is as far as Maxwell model and Kelvin Voigt model are concerned. Now, obviously, real material is far more complicated than either of the Kelvin Voigt response or a Maxwell response. All right. So, typically what is done at a simplistic level, what is done is that you consider some specific arrangements of springs and dashpots and try to see whether that specific arrangements of little more complicated than Maxwell or Kelvin Voigt and see whether that arrangement explains material behavior well or not. A typical arrangement little bit more involved than single Maxwell or a single Kelvin Voigt is essentially series arrangement of Kelvin Voigt and Maxwell. All right, but there is no limit to this. There can be many such arrangements. Okay, and whenever there is anything in series, there is the stress is constant in that. Whenever there is parallel, strain is constant in that. By doing that, you can develop a differential equation for that and solve that equation. All right, but there is more systematic way of addressing that particular problem, and that is by considering a parallel arrangement of Maxwell models and series arrangement of Kelvin Voigt models. Okay. So, this is a series, a parallel arrangement of Maxwell models, and you can kind of name individual modulus at G1, G2 up to let us say Gn, and eta 1, eta 2 up to eta n. Now, stress in these individual Maxwell elements is now additive. Strain in individual Maxwell is identical. All right. So, you can represent this particular model arrangement as sigma is equal to summation sigma I, where individual sigma I is given by the Maxwell model, which is gamma dot is equal to sigma I dot by G plus sigma dot by eta, sigma I by eta. So, this is individual Maxwell for ith mode, all right. Gamma is constant for all the modes, and so this for I equal to 1 to n are the n differential equations, and one equation that essentially adds all the stresses that will give you a constitutive equation for Maxwell model, all right. Similarly, a Kelvin-Voigt model is essentially given. Something like this. Is that all right? So, this is Kelvin-Voigt model. What is in case of Kelvin-Voigt model? Strain is additive over here. So, total gamma is equal to summation over I gamma I, while, but stress is constant. So, what you have is, I am sorry, here it should be gi and eta i, because gi is different for every Maxwell and eta is different for every Maxwell. So, similarly over I can write down g I gamma I plus eta I gamma dot I, that gives me Kelvin-Voigt model. What is beauty of generalized Maxwell? So, this particular model is known as either multimode Maxwell model or generalized Maxwell model. This model is known as multimode Kelvin-Voigt model or generalized Kelvin-Voigt model. The beauty of these is that both models are equivalent to each other. All right. So, if you have any, let us say, material, any viscoelastic material can be completely defined by generalized Maxwell model or generalized Kelvin-Voigt model, which also means that for the every generalized Maxwell construction, there exists a generalized Kelvin-Voigt construction. All right. What does this give? This gives you a series of GIs and eta I's, or GIs and relaxation times. So, since a real material does not have a single relaxation time, it has a distribution of relaxation times. Similarly, that material also has distribution of retardation times, all right, which simply means that with knowledge of these GIs and tau i's, you can get these GIs and tau i's. Keep in mind that these GIs and these GIs are not identical, obviously not, they are different. These GIs are associated with Kelvin-Voigt model, these GIs are associated with Maxwell model. Fair enough? So, for every generalized Kelvin-Voigt model, there exists a generalized Maxwell model, and any viscoelastic material can be completely represented by either of them. It is a very, very strong statement. The obvious question that you guys will ask me is that if material has, obviously, anybody will agree with me that if n goes to infinity, then well, probably you can fit anything in the world, but at what cost? With so many equations, because for every mode, every Maxwell element in this particular generalized Maxwell model is known as Maxwell mode, all right, and it represents a one relaxation time scale. So, when we say multi-mode, which means that we have multiple relaxation time scales. For every mode, we have one differential equation over here, all right. Yes, I agree that in differential representation, it looks quite cumbersome. So, let us now do next step, that let us transform this differential equation into integral equation, and then what we get is wealth of information, all right. So, let us do that. So, we will write down the expression for Maxwell model. what is the expression for Maxwell model? We will first kind of deal with a single mode Maxwell model, and single mode Maxwell model is simply given by gamma dot is equal to sigma dot by gi by g plus sigma by eta. Alright, this is our single mode Maxwell model, and what we shall do now is that we will write down this particular expression in the following fashion. We will write down sigma dot plus g by eta into sigma plus equal to what we essentially have is that g into gamma dot. Does this look okay? We have simply multiplied this particular whole equation by g. All right. What this particular expression looks like is a typical representative expression where we have dy by dx plus p of x into y is equal to q of x. Here, of course, x is nothing but time. Let me write down this then as d sigma by dt, y is sigma, and p of x is essentially p is equal to g by eta and q is equal to g. Who will tell me solution of this particular differential equation? Yes. Y is equal to, come on guys, yes, e to the power integral of p dx into q x integral q e to the power minus p dx dx plus I am just remembering whether this is minus over here or this is minus over here. It is minus here, right, Shankar? Minus here and plus there, no? Yeah. Whenever you have a problem, go to Shankar. Okay. So this is the expression. Fine. So this is equal to, let us now just simply put everything over here, e to the power minus, what is p here? P is g by eta. So, we have dt, we know that g by eta is 1 over relaxation time. So, let us put this as tau r, and this goes from 0 to t plus, here limits are really very important, all right. So, please keep your eye on the limits. So, this of course is t, this is y is sigma as a function of t, this q is nothing but g, g is constant as far as our single mode Maxwell is concerned, e to the power, what we have is that dt prime divided by tau r from 0 to t prime. X here is, we will call it now t prime plus k. All right, we have not yet defined this particular limit as yet. Please let me know if I am missing something. I do not think so. Is this something? And the gamma dot, yes, of course, very important. This q, why did you guys tell me this is not g, this is gamma dot? All right. So, keep in mind that this lower limit is very intimately related to this particular k over here. All right. What we shall do is that we shall multiply this, we will compute this, this is very straightforward, put it inside and see what we get, and then we will take a decision on this particular limit. So, what we have is that t, this is g, this becomes e to the power minus, this is minus t minus T prime divided by tau r d gamma by dt prime plus k is e to the power minus t by tau r to k. Is this okay? Of course, it is equal to. And what we shall now do is that we will try to compute stress in a material at time t is equal to minus infinity. Okay. And if we do that, you will realize that at this particular time, this term will be e to the power minus of minus infinity, this term will blow up. On the other hand, there will be minus infinity over here, all right. So, just in order to have stress finite in a material at time t equal to minus infinity, what we shall do is that we will put this particular k equal to 0 and we will use this particular term minus infinity over here. So, that at t equal to minus infinity, what we essentially have is 0 stress in material. So, this becomes our integral expression for single mode Maxwell. Is that all right? This becomes an integral expression for single mode Maxwell. Now, if we have a multimode system like this, how we can modify this? How we can modify that particular expression to this? Anybody quickly? Yes. Stress in every element is independent. Okay. You can add that particular stress. I should not say independent, it is additive. So, total sigma is equal to summation sigma I, which I can now write down as minus infinity to t summation g I e to the power minus t minus t prime by tau r sub I. d gamma by dt prime. Well, now this summation is from I is equal to 1 to n, all right. So, now you can see that the expression that was really huge for many, if you have let us say hundreds of let us say Maxwell modes, then you have hundreds of these equations, but all these equations essentially boil down to a single expression when it comes to integral model. What does this equation is trying to tell you? Okay. What this equation is essentially telling you is as follows, that you can consider that this outside integral is kind of a summation. Forget about the inside. Inside integral essentially represents a model, or inside summation represents a material. So, this represents a material, and this integration essentially represents effect of applied strain, which leads to stress. All right. So, this equation is telling you that application of strain induces stress in material. Listen to me carefully. Application of strain induces stress in material, but the strain which was induced, strain which was applied to material has a greater weight if that strain is applied in immediate past than in distant past, because of this particular exponential sign over here. All right. Let us try to represent this particular expression, then what I am saying will become more clear to you guys. So, we shall call this particular, what is represented in this curly bracket, we will represent it now as okay. So, therefore, the stress can be represented as minus infinity to t g of t minus t prime d gamma by d t prime. All right. This is g of t minus t prime. So, what I will do now is I will plot g of t minus t prime as a function of t minus t prime. All right. If I plot this in a double logarithmic plot, then I will get this particular response like this. All right. Now, let us consider how to read this particular expression and apply it through this particular plot. Okay. Consider that the strain is induced in material, strain is applied to the material at time t prime. Strain is applied. So, let us say if this is the time axis, if this is present time t, time started at certain time minus infinity, this is present time t, and the strain is applied to material at different t primes. You can see here that this t prime is going from minus infinity to t. This t prime is going from minus infinity to t, and this strain is applied to material at different times. Okay. We are representing it as t minus t prime. So, we are calculating time back from here. If t minus t prime is small, then the weight, this weight which multiplies the applied strain, strain rate in this case, is large. So, for immediate past, material remembers application of strain much more strongly than when that strain is applied in the distant past. Are you getting meaning of this? So, this essentially gives you a flavor of something called fading memory. Okay. The memory fades as time passes further. All right. And eventually, as time t equal, as this becomes really very large, larger than the largest relaxation time in this, the stress is no longer stored, the energy is no longer stored in material, and material completely relaxes. Okay. So, this g of t minus t prime is known as relaxation modulus. All right. And this is an expression of generalized Maxwell model in integral form. Is that all right? So, what shall we now do is that I will just begin with, I will take 5 more minutes, I will just begin with formal development of linear viscoelasticity, and when we meet in the next class, what we shall do is that we shall develop this equation from little bit more abstract way. This expression is also known as Boltzmann superposition principle, but we will develop it from bit an abstract way, not from this, and you will appreciate to see the similarity between this expression. You can see here that this expression is requires input of strain and output as stress. You can, from that abstract way, you can also do identically, you can have input of stress and output of strain. You can do that also by integrating Kelvin-Wirth model. Okay, that is also possible. generalized Kevin Hilbert model, all right. And then we shall develop these two expressions for Boltzmann superposition principle. If you take Laplace transform of that, Laplace transform simplifies the whole linear viscoelastic analysis, which kind of I will just give that flavor in the next class. And when Laplace transform of stress explicit and strain explicit expressions is compared, what you get is something called convolution of response function associated with strain input and response function associated with stress input. We will derive that as well in the next class, all right. And then I will go to little bit more practical applications of something called linear viscoelasticity, wherein we shall study application of oscillatory flow field. What is physical meaning of something called elastic modulus G prime, viscous modulus G double prime, how elastic and viscous modulus are read, what is the relationship between elastic and viscous modulus for a given material. So, we shall do all these kinds of things in the next class, all right. And if time permits, I would like to talk about thixotropy as well as yield stress. But if you really have to solve either of these particular models in a differential pattern, then what you shall have to do? You will have to kind of carry out an exercise that we carried out for simple Maxwell and Kelvin void. But as the number of modes increase, what you will get is a more involved differential equation, all right. A typical generalized differential equation for linear viscoelasticity is given by 1 plus alpha 1 dou by dou t alpha 2 So, this is the sorry, it is n in this case and m in this case. Usually for any model is it either n is equal to m or n is equal to m minus 1. So, this is a generalized differential equation for linear viscoelasticity. It is a linear equation. Keep in mind that alphas and betas are constants, all right, and they are not function of either time, stress or strain. Why linear viscoelasticity? Because we have considered a linear spring and linear dashpot. But there is much more meaning to this word linear, much more physical meaning to this word linear that makes it extremely important from its applications point of view, which I will discuss with you in the next class when we will talk more about the oscillatory flow. Is that all right? So, should we stop today's class here?